Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome back to Podcast Stardust. This is the galaxy source for news, reviews, and discussion. Jay, before we get into this week's discussion of The Mandalorian, can you remind everyone where they can find us online and around the internet?
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust, and we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So today we are discussing Chapter 14 of The Mandalorian, and as always, this is a full spoiler discussion. By the time this episode goes live, the episode of The Mandalorian will have been out for a week. But with that being said, if you haven't seen it, then you might want to skip this one until you do. But with that being said, Jay, can you please give us the summary for Chapter 14, The Tragedy?
Sure. The Mandalorian and the Child, also known as Din Djarin and Grogu, make it to Tython and the ancient Jedi Temple. After initially failing to reach out through the Force with the Seeing Stone, Grogu activates the temple as an unexpected ship arrives, Slave One. When the Mandalorian moves to investigate, he discovers that Boba Fett tracked him down, and he wants his armor back. Plus, he is not alone. Fennec Shand, the assassin, is with him. They offer to protect Grogu in exchange for Boba Fett's armor. Before the negotiations go anywhere, the Empire arrives. As stormtroopers attack, Din tries to recover Grogu, but he is knocked unconscious by Grogu's force field. Boba recovers his armor from the Razor Crest, and he and Fennec begin fighting off the stormtroopers. After Din recovers, he joins the fight, and they drive off the stormtroopers. The Empire is not defeated yet. The Razor Crest is destroyed by a blast from Gideon's light cruiser. Then, dark troopers are dispatched to retrieve the child. Boba and Fennec vow to assist Din in rescuing the child, and they return to Navarro on Slave One, where Din recruits Cara Dune and says they need to spring the former Imperial sharpshooter Mayfield from prison. The episode concludes with Grand Moff Gideon observing Grogu battling stormtroopers in his cell with the Force. After Grogu wears himself out, Gideon taunts him and has another stormtrooper stun him and put him in shackles.
You know, as you're reading that summary there, it occurred to me that I'm still caught up in calling the child, as opposed to Grogu, because of the way I wrote that. So I think
we all are. I mean, yeah. Come on, you know, we've been doing this for a year now, and he still is the child. He is a child.
Right. It took me long enough to quit calling him Baby Yoda. And
right.
Then now I got myself set on the child, and going from there to Grogu will be a task. But that said, what did you think of this episode overall?
Oh my goodness. I mean, it just keeps getting better and better and better. I'm just from the very first moment seeing those words, the tragedy, of course, my mind is going, okay, what's the tragedy going to be? Mm-hmm. And honestly, that's one of the questions that's still in my mind. We're going to have to talk about this because I want to pick your brain, like what the tragedy actually is. But I think that this episode was incredible. There was so much great action in this. We get Boba Fett back in more than just, you know, simple action. I mean, he's going at it with so many things. Fennec Shand is back. I mean, everything that I just read in that great summary that you wrote for me is insane. I mean, and oh my God, the Razor Crest. Hello. Yeah. What? Rip. I tell you what, this episode, I was laying there at 5 o'clock in the morning trying not to scream with everything that was going on. So right. We'll get into the details, but that is my very animated summary of my overall thoughts. So how about you?
Well, you and I have been joking for a while now about which ship has had the harsher existence, the Razor Crest or the Millennium Falcon. Well, that question's been forever put to rest. That one's done. Yeah. Rest in peace, Razor Crest. I feel bad for everyone who backed it on HasLab.
That's one of the first things I thought of. Oh my gosh, yeah.
But like you, when I saw the title of the episode, The Tragedy, I was like, wait, what? Please tell me that there's some new character we don't know yet that's going to have a tragedy, because I was not prepared for anything to happen to the child or the Mandalorian or whatever. And I certainly did not guess that the Razor Crest was going to get destroyed in this episode. And frankly, I had no idea that it was going to be Boba Fett and Fennec Shand showing up here as well. I always knew that that was a possibility, but I think at this point I kind of resigned myself to them showing up later. So with that having been said, let's talk about Boba Fett, because that is the big, well, one of the big developments here. But what did you think of his appearance here in this chapter?
Okay, well, you know, I don't normally resort to any kind of colorful language, but this is the most badass I've ever even would have thought that Boba Fett could have ever been. Mm-hmm. And I think that this lays to rest a lot of the, you know, kind of jabbing that he got because the way that he went out in Return of the Jedi. And of course, it shows us just how tough that he is, and what a gunslinger. Oh my goodness. And just incredible to watch. Absolutely incredible to watch. That's my overall thoughts, but we'll get into more. How about you?
I thought he was incredible. This is the most threatening Boba Fett has ever been.
Mm-hmm.
I think it benefited a bit from Robert Rodriguez directing the episode, but I'm confident that any number of other directors would have made him just as impressive here. But let's think about Boba Fett for a second and what we know of him. As you alluded to, the last we saw of him in the timeline was getting punked by Han Solo on Tatooine and him flying out of control into the side of the sail barge and into the Sarlacc pit. Well, that's not true. I'm sorry. The last we saw him before the series, I should say. And then we got a brief glimpse of him in this series, but he didn't do anything really, except for he saw Din Djarin riding around on his bike, and then he turned around and walked towards the camera prior to that. Second, what we really, the most development we got from him was during the Clone Wars series, when he was kind of a brat most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And he had very questionable morals and ethics. Now, I'm not saying all those questions have been resolved, because he had Fennec Shand take aim at Grogu in order to try and get what he wanted at the beginning. But that being said, he does have his own code of honor here. And he told Den that, you give me the armor and we will guarantee your and Grogu's safety. He didn't put it quite that way, but that was the gist. And when this whole episode was over, he told Den that until the child is safe, see, I'm doing it again, until Grogu is safe, that they're in his service. So I really like that development. I thought it was fantastic.
I do as well. And there's so much, I think just in this one episode, there's so much character development to Boba Fett that we've always wanted to see, and we never really quite knew where his character art went. And you're absolutely right. In the Clone Wars, we saw him as a teenager, essentially. And he was really just kind of finding himself as a bounty hunter and really just kind of making his way, you know, to use his words, simple man making his way through the universe and through the galaxy, which I absolutely love the fact that he repeated that line as mm-hmm. both father and son, can I just say. But at any rate, it's one of those amazing things to see how he's come to this point. And you're absolutely right. He's got this code of honor. And it's interesting, too, because in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, and we could get into a real deep dive into Boba Fett here, but I don't want to take too much time on that. We could have a whole episode on that. But with his chain code that he showed to Din, you could see, and I saw some people that were translating the Mandoay, and there's kind of a part cut off to it where you see like this Jaster Mereel.
Yeah.
Right. So in what we know in Legends, and I don't know, is this also considered canon that Jango Fett was, he was a farmer. He came from a farm family, and his family was actually murdered by Death Watch. And Jaster Mereel took Jango under his wing and trained him as a Mandalorian warrior. So we're kind of getting set up for this whole thing between, even though he's considered a foundling, but he was a foundling by Jaster Mereel, not by Death Watch. So we've got these two warring clans kind of, and that's, you know, as far as where Din is coming from, he's a child of the Watch. And then you've got Boba Fett. So I'm intrigued by this. I know I'm like bouncing all over the place, Dennis, and that's mm-hmm. that's my right brain personality coming in here. But you know how much I love Boba Fett, and I've always been a Boba Fett apologist to, you know, to the last. So
yeah, I think though the thing is that most of us that really like Boba Fett, it's because what he did in Legends and the stuff that was the books and the comics. And not for real anything that he did on screen. And this changes all that. And to kind of expand on some of the things that you were saying, I don't know whether or not that Jango is a son of farmers that gets brought into the Mandalorian way of life, if that will survive or not. You can't rule it out based on what we saw in the chain code here. But Boba Fett points out that Jango was his father. Interesting, he doesn't mention anything about cloning. And mm-hmm. I want to get back to that cloning point in just a second. But two, he mentions that Jango even fought in the Mandalorian Civil Wars.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been around for a while, and they've definitively made Boba and Jango Mandalorians now. And Almec had said that they're no Mandalorians. Yeah, Jango is not a Mandalorian. So that's been done away with. They are now officially Mandalorians here. They are part of that culture, which I really liked. I didn't like this whole idea that they were just rogues that acquired Mandalorian armor and were running around with it. I like that Jango has always had some sort of a code of honor that came up in the novelization from Attack of the Clones by R.A. Salvatore. And it was expanded upon in various Legends books. And that's fantastic. But that there is something more than Jango than just being a cutthroat bounty hunter out there trying to make his way in the galaxy, despite what he says. That's right. Just him being humble. And so, yeah, so that's part of it. On top of that, just seeing Boba go all out, it's too bad he didn't have a Z-11 blaster with him, his mm-hmm. traditional rifle there, but just seeing him with his pistol, taking the Tusken Raiders gaffy stick, and just destroying stormtroopers with it, it really kind of created an issue for me that, you know, he put all this force into destroying stormtroopers, and then I was thinking of like guys like Chirrut Imwe, and then the knee rockets.
Oh my gosh, the knee rockets, those were amazing. Hello. And then the no look shot that he took, just mm-hmm. so insane. But I think my favorite part, and this just shows just his personality, is when he used his rocket to shoot down the transport, and Din was like, "Nice shot." And he goes, "I hit the wrong one.
No, I was actually aiming for the other one."
I was actually aiming for the other one. So it wasn't just like, "Oh yeah, thanks. I meant to do that." He was all about it. Yeah. Well, whoops, but it worked out okay. That actually brings me back to a little bit of his personality, even in the Clone Wars. Even though he was kind of a brat, he was still that way. But that's evolved so much, and I love it. And to put into context too what you were saying about Almec, for our listeners that may not be super familiar with the Clone Wars, this is a reference from the Clone Wars. And so Almec was on Mandalore at the time, and I all I could think to myself too was like, take that, Almec. I thought mm-hmm. the same thing, and it lays all of that to rest. You're right. It's so great.
Well, one last thing I want to say about Boba Fett, because we could geek about him for 45 minutes.
Oh, sure.
And I'm sure we'll do that some more as this discussion progresses. But there's a definite maturity to him that was absent. And you can kind of see a character arc for him if you look at the way he was from Attack of the Clones throughout the Clone Wars till when we saw him in the movies, the original trilogy, to now. And in Attack of the Clones, he was the apprentice to his father, the master, the bounty hunter in waiting. And then his whole world was rocked when Jango was killed by Mace Windu. And then in the Clone Wars, he was angry all the time, and that anger drove him for so long, landed him in prison, caused him to take jobs that were not in his and his crew's best interest. It was actually Hondo Ohnaka that pointed out to him the folly and what he was doing, and that's not mm-hmm. what his father would have done. And then when we get to the original trilogy and some of the comics around is that he's dedicated to his job and he's doing the job and he's about the job. But now, and who's to say, I don't know for certain that he isn't going to resume the life of a bounty hunter or whatever he's going to do. He's got Slave One, so he could have got off Tatooine at any time, as far as I can tell, but he was certainly hanging around there for some reason. But he's very much now considering a code that's larger than himself. And I just think that's an awesome development for this character for the lifespan that we've known him.
I agree. And I think that his experience on Tatooine did kind of have a real soul searching aspect to it. And that really did contribute to his evolution as a character. And I guess my question is, you know, now that you bring it up, I wonder why he never did leave Tatooine if he could have. Why did he, you know, I guess maybe he was just in search of his armor that whole time.
He seemed to know where it was, though, because he told Din the armor you took from Cobb Vanth.
That's true.
So
that's true.
I wonder what the reason was that he didn't wander into Mos Pelgo and just take it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure he had his reason. Maybe it had something to do with his honor. But now that it's not needed by the people of Mos Pelgo to defend themselves from Tusken Raiders and the Mining Guild, that he feels like he can demand it. So that's speculation on my part, but hopefully we'll get that answer someday. And if we get the rumored Boba Fett series, then maybe it'll come then. So let's talk about the other guest star, Fennec Shand, in this one. I guess I'm not terribly surprised that when she returns to the show, it's with Boba Fett, given the end of chapter 5 from season 1. And that's where we last saw her, was in Tatooine. And so, but I'm not certain I was still expecting to see her this episode. Well, I wasn't expecting to see Boba Fett either. But what did you think about her return?
I was so happy. Well, you know, when we were talking about this last season, I was kind of hoping that it was going to be either Cad Bane, you know, or somebody like that that was walking up to her body. And everyone else was saying, oh, it's Boba Fett. Well, I'm glad it's Boba Fett. I'm not going to lie. And there was, most people said, no, she's not going to survive. You know, look how she got shot. Well, I said, nope. I think she's going to live. And now she's the cyborg, which I thought was kind of interesting that she just like nonchalantly just said, you know, kind of opened up that little area and showed off her cyborgness. She was super cool. She had a real, and I know she was kind of dressed this way before, but she kind of reminded me of Zam Weasel a little bit in this.
Yeah, I was thinking Zam Weasel as well. I really liked the look that she had there. And one of the things about this was, despite how awesome Boba Fett was, my favorite shot from this entire episode was her jumping off backwards the side of the cliff and taking down the stormtroopers. And then she lands on her back, rolls up, and shoots a few more. There was, in an episode that was full of such great action, that was the best action moment of the entire episode for me.
Oh, I agree. And I've seen that image repeated so many times in so many different places. And we got to give it up for Lauren Mary Kim, because she was the one that did all of the stunts once again for Ming-Na Wen. So I know Ming-Na did a few of her own things, but it was a lot of the stuff like that was Lauren Mary Kim. So
she's definitely the go-to for
for
the stunts this season, which is just incredible. I love that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you were showing me earlier today a video that she did with someone on that's just got posted to Instagram, her Instagram page, fighting with the darksaber, which is really cool.
Yes. Yeah, she and Amy Johnston, who does stunts, I believe Amy Johnston actually does for Black Widow, if I'm not mistaken. But they just decided one day that they just wanted to go out and have fun and do a little fan video. And so it's about 3 minutes long. It's incredible. If anybody gets a chance to check it out, you go to Lauren Mary Kim's Instagram or just look it up on YouTube. It's so good.
It's easy enough to find. I found it in 2 seconds when you told me about it. So yeah, I was glad to see her again. I just felt like Ming-Na Wen dying in half an episode in season one was a complete waste of her talent. So I'm glad they brought her back, and her look was incredible. The action that she was involved in was fantastic. If they go forward with the Boba Fett series, and if it progresses from this point or from this series onward, I hope she is an active part of that series with Boba Fett. That would just be an incredible duo to follow around the galaxy on their adventures, whatever that might be. And whether they get caught up in the efforts to retake Mandalore or something else, I'm all in. Bring it on.
Oh, yeah.
Let's definitely do that.
Take my money for sure, even if it's not on Disney Plus. But I have to ask you a question. So she's part cyborg. Mm-hmm. And she went out of her way to show Din this and to explain that it was Boba Fett that helped her to recover. So I guess my question is, where did they go to get this done? So who does Boba Fett know that was doing this kind of work? And does Boba have some cyborgness too? You know, after, what a word, right? Cyborgness. But after he was obviously partially digested in the Sarlacc, and let's just pause for a second to recognize that about his look, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where did they get this done?
I don't know that we can answer that.
I'm just like throwing that out in the universe, but
yeah, a couple things come to mind, which is, this is a kid who grew up with Kaminoans, and they had all kinds of scientific advancements there. He had Slave One at his disposal. I mean, that's what he flew to Tython from Tatooine. Who's to say that they didn't go back to Kaminoa, if that's even still around? I'm not sure what the Empire did with that exactly. So, or maybe there's someone in Mos Espa, because that's where Ming-Na Wen was headed. And maybe it was to meet with Boba Fett. We don't know who her contact was that she was supposed to meet there back in Chapter 5. But regardless, another thought that comes to mind, I don't think cybernetics are that rare a thing, because Luke sure did find a cybernetic hand with the Rebellion pretty easily after he lost one. True. I think Ming-Na Wen's procedure probably would have been a bit more complicated, since it seemed to be her entire midsection that was replaced there. But yeah, that could be an interesting story. I'm not sure that's one that we'll necessarily get during live action, a series sometimes, but this is another thing, just kind of like Lang, that character from the previous episode, I kind of expect to show up in a comic or a book or some sort of a tie-in at some point.
I kind of hope so, because yeah, again, you talk about a waste of a character, and we discussed this last episode too. He was just kind of there.
Mm-hmm.
But I am super excited to hear if there's going to be anything explained from this. And I'm just so happy that the three of these three characters, Din and Fennec and Boba, are going to be working together for the, you know, foreseeable future here, because what a dream team.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And then they add Cara Dune, and I'm assuming Greef Karga might be along for the ride.
Yeah.
Throw Mayfield into that, and you want to talk about your Bad Batch.
Yeah. So, that's a great way to put it. The Mandalorian, yeah. Bad Batch.
Right. So the Dark Troopers, we speculated about them a ton a couple episodes ago, and here they are. And I mean, it's no doubt that's what they are. Moff Gideon said, have the Dark Troopers been engaged? And then he was told it momentarily, and they streaked down to the temple and grabbed Grogu and brought him back. But what did you think about them?
Well, my first impression was, ooh, Iron Man people.
Yeah.
But they're so cool. And, yeah, you know, we saw these Dark Troopers, of course, like we said in the other episode. But I know you know more about these than I do. I understand that they're from the comics or from the video games, and they're half human. Is that what I'm understanding?
No. Well, they've changed quite a bit. They're originally from the Dark Forces computer game that came out that introduced Kyle Katarn. And there were three different phases of them then. And the first phase was purely an android. The second phase was an android with more stuff. And the third phase was as well. Other sources have made them armor with Force-sensitive individuals inside. It's changed from place to place. It was an inconsistency in Legends. These appeared to me to be pure robotic, pure droid in this version here. They were very stiff in their movement that way. Their joints were not something that I could see someone's arm going through. They mm-hmm. you know, where the elbow was a pure joint, not something that like an Iron Man type of a suit of armor or anything like that. So if they are following the Dark Forces video game, then these are just droids. But okay, that leaves open a lot of possibility. They seem to be too synchronous in order to be four individuals, and therefore that's my conclusion on it. But no, I'm pretty sure those are just droids.
So you're thinking that they're kind of like the drone droid kind of controlled sort of thing by whoever is in charge of Moff Gideon's troops.
That's a possibility. Yeah. I don't know how autonomous they are, but mm-hmm. I gotta believe we'll find out over the next two chapters, last two chapters of the show.
So we don't see, I'm asking you a lot of questions, and these are just throwing these out in the universe. I don't expect you to have answers, but speculation maybe. Where, you know, we don't see these troopers again ever anywhere. So this has got to be Moff Gideon's pet project, much as the TIE Defender project was for Thrawn, question mark. What are your thoughts on that?
Right. I agree with you there. Because I got to feel like if these were an effective, sustainable thing, then some version of them showed up in the sequel trilogy. But when they were introduced in the computer game, yeah, it was a pet project. And by the end, that project was destroyed by Kyle Katarn. And then it cropped up in other places and stuff like that. So that's what I'm guessing here, is that by the end of Moff Gideon's involvement in this series, then the Dark Troopers go with him as well. And kind of like when the TIE Defender funding lost out to the Death Star, something like that's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's kind of where my brain was going to, that it somehow died out because they're all fighting for their different pet projects.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk a bit about Grogu here. They get to Tython. First off, what did you think of Tython? What did you think about the temple there?
It was amazing. I mean, the first thought that popped into my head was from Outlander, seeing the, and I know various people have referenced it to Stonehenge in the way that the stones are kind of leaning and it's in a circular pattern. But my mind kind of went, and it's funny because my husband said the same thing. We're both big Outlander fans. And he said, "Ooh, I wonder if the stones are going to start sounding like bees buzzing." And Din better run if he hears it too. But so we were kind of joking about that. But it's very organic in a way that I would expect a Jedi temple to be, you know, much like we've seen some of these other kind of force centric sorts of places like Octu, like Dagobah, you know, even on Lothal. And what kind of struck me about this was that you don't really see a whole lot other than just the top of this temple, like the seeing stone in these rocks. So I'm wondering if it's awesome. Something, you know, similar to Lothal, where it's more in, like in the ground or in, you know what I mean? Like in the earth,
sure.
That it might have to emerge, but maybe it's just grown over as well.
Yeah, we know it's ruins. That was described by Ahsoka in the past. And I got to frank, I was expecting a little bit more. What we got was fine. Stonehenge was exactly what I was thinking when you said that. And I guess perhaps I was thinking that kind of like the Sith temples we've seen on Malachor or whatever, that there would be more of an exterior to it. I'm thinking more recently in the Marvel comics when Luke took Ben to a temple in the Outer Rim, that something more like that. I was not expecting just this almost ritual circle type looking thing. It was more of that than it was an actual temple in appearance. So
very primitive.
Yeah, very primitive, but it certainly did the job.
Right. And I guess that makes sense, though, because it's said to be one of the very first Jedi temples ever. Mm-hmm. And I know even from Legends, that's where the Jedi had practiced. And there was the two moons, Ashla and Bogan, which are the light side and the dark side of the Force. So I don't know if any of that's ever going to come out. And of course, we know Tython, we mentioned this last episode as well, from the Darth Bane trilogy. So there's a lot of history there. And I love the fact, though, that they're bringing all this into The Mandalorian. I really do. And it makes us wonder, you know, if there are these bridges that are being built between these two things. And I wouldn't put it past, you know, Favreau and Filoni to do that. But
Filoni's always seemed like someone who is perfectly willing to bring in a concept from Legends if it fulfills his purpose, which is I need a brilliant tactician for the Empire that is capable of analyzing minute details and coming up with a way to defeat the rebels. Well, there's already a guy like that. That's Thrawn.
Hey, Thrawn, yeah.
So let's bring him in. Why create a new character? Let's bring someone in that everyone likes him. It won't be the exact same story. It won't be the exact same character, but it'll be close enough. And so I need an ancient world where the Jedi were founded or had early beginnings or had an early presence. Tython. Why do we need another new world? This one works just as well. It may not look exactly like what we are used to with Tython, but that doesn't really matter, does it? So it was a nice addition to the show, and I'm glad that they continue to go to the Legends well for these type of things. We're not going to completely reconcile those two stories, but we can draw some links between them. And as we're all so fond of quoting Ahsoka, there's always a bit of truth in Legends.
Mm.
Yeah, let's do that.
Said, yes.
But so Grogu gets set on the Seeing Stone by Din Djarin, who is so impatient at this point, which is, you know, so are you seeing anything? Come on, kid. The nice lady said that all I did was bring you here.
Oh,
you do
my
the work.
Gosh. And can we just pause for a second? The nice lady.
Yeah.
I love that. Made me chuckle so hard. Speaking of Ahsoka as the nice lady said.
Yeah. And he's really anxious for Grogu to get onto, because at the beginning of this episode, he was in the ship and he's testing out Grogu's name. He's getting a kick out of saying Grogu and having the child look up at him like, what? And then he takes away the knob from the controller stick. He calls it a ball. And then he has Grogu pick it. And then as soon as Grogu grabs it, you know, he does the Din Ferrick thing, just kind of as an exclamation, not a swear. And Grogu drops the whole thing, like, what did I do wrong? And so Din has to reassure him. But he's really... Okay, I guess the best way I can say this is just where I'm going with this. My read on this was he's not ready to hand Grogu over to the Jedi, but he knows he's going to have to. So he's trying to convince Grogu, okay, you're going to go with the Jedi if they come to get you, right? You understand this, and let's get it over with because I can't stand this anymore.
Yeah.
Was kind of my read on it.
It's kind of the inevitable, bittersweet kind of, this is my mission, yet I don't really want to complete it. Almost a be careful what you wish for kind of a thing. But yeah, the whole Din Djarin thing, I looked it up because it's been a term that's been used quite a bit. We even saw it in the very first episode the very first chapter, I should say, of The Mandalorian, when the Mithral said it. And so I understood it to mean, thank goodness. But the way that it's been used in the last couple of episodes, especially by Din, is almost like a gosh darn it, you know, sort of a thing. And in this place, it seems correct, as you said, because he's almost in a way kind of sad that he can use the Force on demand like that. Or maybe, you know, it's almost one of those things where did he say it like, gosh darn it, or thank goodness, you know, you can do this.
Okay. Well, I remember Cara Dune used it in a prior episode, and it was very much as a swear.
Yes.
And how do I want to do this? When he used it in this episode, it was almost like he was saying, holy bleep. It's kind of an exclamation that it works, and he was just kind of getting a kick out of it. And so I'm not sure that in that regards, thank goodness really works as a translation, because it's frequently something that he said like under his breath.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, dang Ferrick. And that type of thing. So yeah, he's not ready to get over the child here. But he's also pleased to see that Grogu's got this power. It is kind of a proud papa moment here. It's been weird, his relationship with Grogu. It's kind of been, yeah, the kid's tagging along. I'm charged with keeping him safe. And then it's turned into more of a parental thing. I don't think it was a parental thing as early as a lot of people think it was. I think that's much more of a recent development here, as he's dragged this kid around the galaxy trying to find the Jedi. And now that they're getting close, the truth is really settling in that his time with Grogu may be limited.
That
is kind of depressing him, because that's it's defined his identity for a while now.
And that's completely understandable. I can empathize with that so much. And I'm sure you can as a parent, too. Mm-hmm. You love to watch your kids do things that, number one, make them happy. Number two, that they can excel at and that they're good at. And that's basically our job as parents. We're raising adults, not children. And so you want them to achieve, and you want them to spread their wings, and you want them to go out and be successful on their own. But yet when the time comes to let go, it's a little hard to do.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. And as far as the Dank Ferrick thing goes, if any of our listeners know exactly what that means, or you have any take on that, email us at podcastartist@retrozap.com, please.
Right.
We need to know.
So Grogu is not apparently interested in reaching out with the Force here on the Seeing Stone. But just when Din's decided that time is up and Slave One shows up, he turns around and there Grogu is. He is the shield's up around him. He's doing that little Buddhist, or I'm not sure exactly what religion that was, pose, where he has the two fingers curled together and one sticking out, and he's meditating in the Force, or that's what it appears. It's really hard to say. I can't decide if he is listening, if he's reaching out, if he's communing, or what exactly is going on there. But what do you think?
Well, it happened so fast. It was almost as if as soon as he touched the stone in a certain place, because there's, you know, the alphabet that's around the stone itself. And I don't even know what language that is. Maybe you do. And it just seemed like as soon as he touched it, it just started kind of happening. It was almost, I hate to say a psychometry kind of a thing, but maybe it was. But I've never seen anything like that Force column that came up around him before. That was something completely new and different, I feel like.
Right.
What did you think?
Well, it seemed to me that he was trying to get off the stone to follow Den. And then all of a sudden it started. And then it was just kind of like, oh, well, while I'm here. And so, but because I don't think he really had an interest in reaching out the way that started. He was more interested in the butterflies that were flying around than he was in actual what was going on with the temple and the Seeing Stone. No matter what Din said to him, it was just kind of like, you know, okay, this is pretty. He enjoyed the flight up in the with the jetpack more than he was interested in being on the Seeing Stone.
Okay, full stop for just a second. The butterflies. The blue butterflies. So what my mind immediately went to is that currently in the fandom for quite a while now, the blue butterflies have been attached to the idea of Ben Solo. And there's a lot of people on Twitter that have the blue butterfly in their handles or their, you know, somewhere in their bio to represent their affiliation or support of Ben Solo. So that's where my mind immediately went. But I know that there's been a lot of butterflies and other things, like even in the Clone Wars. I think that it was like, wasn't it the very, very first episode of the Clone Wars where Yoda's sitting, or he's
yeah,
with
those
the
weren't
clones.
Butterflies, though. Those were little bug creatures on that planet that looked like it was an ocean at one point. The water drained away, and so it kind of looked like shrimp that evolved wings. But
But I know there's some on Endor. There's like these blue Endorian butterflies that are supposed to signify hope.
Okay. For everyone that's hoping for that, more power to you. I don't see the connection myself. The closest I could come with was on the Star Wars Kids YouTube channel. There is the rollout series where all the characters look like BB-8. And a very young Ben Solo goes on an adventure with Han and Chewbacca. And long story short, blue butterflies are involved. And Ben had been kind of tied up in the ship so that he wouldn't follow Han and Chewbacca. They get captured. And then Ben busts himself out by damaging the Falcon. And he and the butterflies engineer an escape. Okay. I'm not certain that that is exactly the way that Lucasfilm was going about their storytelling to make a larger point. But who am I to say? I don't know. I think the butterflies were a nice touch given the environment, but I think we need to be careful about reading too much into that.
Oh, I'm not. Trust me. I'm just, my mind did go to Ben Solo, but that's only because of the fact that we've seen so much of that on social media. I put absolutely no stock in that whatsoever, clear.
It wasn't necessarily directed towards you, but yeah, it's kind of the curse of being a Star Wars fan right now, is that we get so wrapped up in theory building and trying to connect dots between things when quite frequently the simpler explanation is the best one. We need to apply Occam's razor more often, but there it is. So, but yeah, the butterflies were there and it was cute when Grogu reached out to one right before the Force shield went up around him. And so we'll see. I don't know if he's reaching, like I said, I'm not sure if he was reaching out, if he got caught up in that Force field, if there is a Jedi communicating with him, or if he was just communing with the Force in general and somebody will know it. I don't think Ahsoka gave us enough information to tell us how that was going to work.
Right, right. So as far as the Seeing Stone itself, I was thinking, where else do we know anything else about Seeing Stones? And my mind went to The Last Jedi, where Luke was perched to force project himself to fight Ben slash Kylo Ren. So is, would that also be considered a seeing stone? I mean, it didn't have the exact same kind of, you know, force pillar around it, and it didn't have like runes on it or anything. It was even more primitive almost than the one that Grogu was sitting on. But do you think that was a seeing stone, or are there others?
It certainly could be. That's a good observation, because that was the same place that he brought Rey when he was trying to give her lessons, and she reached out in the force and detected the light side and the dark side and everything else. So maybe Jedi temples have these things. When Ahsoka first mentioned the Seeing Stone, I assumed it was a particular one-of-a-kind object, but maybe she's just talking about the Seeing Stone at that Jedi temple, and the temple at Ashto would have its own Seeing Stone, which Luke was using when he was performing his force trick to project his image across the galaxy. So that's a good observation. I don't know, but maybe we'll find out more. I don't think we'll find out from the Mandalorian, but probably, you know, that's always an open possibility for some other source. Okay, well, we're going long here. We got a few more things to get through, so let's try and wrap it up. But one of the things that I wanted to talk about is, okay, Den, the definition of sanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. I am not sure how many times he was going to charge at that force field before it fell, trying to get Grogu. I mean, how many times did he need to get knocked unconscious? I understand he was desperate, but that was one of the flaws of this episode for me. The other one was when he gets into the showdown with Boba Fett and Fennec Shand, and Boba says, "Let's put down our weapons. You put down your jetpack and we'll talk." Well, Boba Fett puts down a rifle. Fennec comes down off the cliff fully armed, and Din puts down his jetpack. But he's still armed. I don't want to say it took me out of the story, because I kind of hate that phrase, but it seemed like a moment that was purely created to propel the story in a direction that Din would not have his jetpack, so he could not get back up to the temple in time to rescue Grogu from the Dark Troopers.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense, because you're absolutely right. Why? What? There's no reason for him to just put down his jetpack, because he's armed to the teeth. Come on.
Yeah, he's got the whistling birds. He's got his pistol. And so, again, that was just kind of a mark against this one. And otherwise, great episode. That and the whole just keep charging the force field thing. Okay, guys, come on.
Right.
Well, and then let's talk about the Razor Crest. I did not see this coming, especially since this ship had just taken a beating for so many episodes and had only been really fully repaired for, what, one and a fifth of an episode prior to this?
Yeah.
And it was all for naught. He lands it on Tython and boom, it's gone.
Holy poodoo. I jumped when this happened. I did not expect this in a million years that this would happen. And it wasn't just destroyed. It was completely
obliterated.
Yeah. Jinx, owe me some spatchka.
Right. So the only thing that was left was the Beskar spear, which Boba Fett recognized immediately, and then the controlling knob that Grogu liked so much. And I knew that was going to be one of the things he found when he was looking around. That seemed a bit obvious. He was going to find that, and that was going to be his memento that was going to encourage him to double down on his quest to rescue Grogu.
Mm-hmm. So a couple of observations here. One, he's got his spear, which is obviously made of Beskar. I wonder if the little ball is made out of Beskar too. But the other thing is, no more pulse rifle. It's gone.
Yeah.
And rip the pulse rifle too, because it's no longer there. So I feel like he's going to, with this spear, this is a melee weapon, essentially. His fighting style is going to have to kind of change maybe a little bit. I mean, I know he still has the whistling birds. He still has, you know, his jetpack, and he still has other ways, like you said, his pistol and that kind of thing, but he doesn't have his pulse rifle anymore. That bums me out.
I feel like the pulse rifle is replaceable, though. The spear, to me, is going to probably take on some sort of a symbolic influence. And frankly, do not expect him to get into a melee duel with Moff Gideon wielding the Darksaber and him using this Beskar spear.
Oh, you're no fun.
To retaliate?
Because that's how kind of what I was hoping for. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, I feel like that's exactly where that's going at that
oh,
point.
Oh, you because... do feel like it's going that way?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. No, I thought you said don't expect it.
No, I said do you expect.
Okay.
Yeah, that's where I feel like this is going with that.
Because I do too.
The Beskar spear would be able to withstand the Darksaber.
Mm-hmm.
We just saw it stand up to Ahsoka's lightsabers, so why not?
And how epic is that to think about this historic Mandalorian weapon wielded by the only Mandalorian Jedi against the most prized possession of the Mandalorians, which is the Beskar. I just think that there's so much cool weight to that. I love it. The symbolism there is amazing.
Right. Yeah. I like it too. So when we get back to, there's two more scenes that are left here. We see Din going back to Cara Dune. We find out that the little trinket that Captain Carson Teva left with Cara was actually a Republic badge, Marshal's badge. And so she's now a Republic Marshal, just not a Marshal for the planet Navarro. And so although she's reluctant to do it, but she seems to be in on this quest to spring Miggs Mayfield from the fields, the chop truck fields that he's been imprisoned on for 50 years, so that Mayfield can help track down Gideon and his cruiser. I'm not sure how the Mandalorian came to the conclusion that Mayfield would be useful in that regard, but there it is. And then the final bit here is on Moff Gideon's cruiser. He shows up in the cell that Grogu's being contained in, and Grogu is just throwing these two stormtroopers around the room and force choking them and letting them have it. And then when he wears himself out, Gideon shows him the Darksaber and then has Grogu stunned, and he puts the tiniest little pair of shackles on him so that they can try and control him. So what are your, as we wrap this up, what are your final thoughts on those scenes?
Well, Cara Dune, I mean, first of all, you know, she's all about, hey, you know, these stripes, they come with something. And then he says they've got the child. And then she just gets this look on her face like, ooh, it's on like Donkey Kong. I love that. I think that the scene with Grogu throwing the stormtroopers around was both entertaining and also kind of gruesome in a way to see, because that's kind of dark side. I mean, in a way, right, that he's throwing these stormtroopers around this way. But I also kind of liken it to the idea of a child throwing a tantrum. You know, you're keeping me from what I want. You're making me upset, and I'm going to make you pay for it. But the way that Moff Gideon talked to him about, you know, it makes you oh so sleepy. It's, do you get the feeling that he's been around the child or Grogu? Listen to me, I'm doing the same thing. That he's been around Grogu a lot more than maybe what we originally thought.
Well, when he shows up in Grogu's cell, he says, you've gotten quite good at that. And so Grogu's been in their possession, and they're also familiar with him. So I don't know exactly how much he's been around Grogu, but he does have some knowledge of Force-sensitive beings. And if nothing else, that suggests to me that Grogu is not the first Force-sensitive that they've been trying to get midichlorians from. And he's learned how to deal with them over time.
Okay.
Because it goes back to that comment in the recording from Dr. Pershing, where he said something about how high the M count was from the donor, which we know to be Grogu here. And so I think that's part of it, is that Gideon is used to dealing with Force-sensitive beings, and he knows that when they expend themselves, especially the untrained ones, they wear themselves out. So there's that. And one thing I want to say about Grogu using the Force there, while it is kind of unnerving how he's just kind of unleashing on these stormtroopers, I agree with you. I am kind of comforted in the fact that he really is doing this in self-defense, that he's been brought, he's a child, he's an infant, he's doing it in self-defense. I don't know exactly how much he understands. We do know he's received training from the Jedi Temple. He is 50 years old, so he would have been cut off from that training over 20-some-odd years ago. but he knew when to cut himself off from the Force for so many years to protect himself. So he has some idea there. That being said, we've also saw him Force choke Cara Dune when he thought Cara was hurting Den in that arm wrestling match. So it'll be interesting to follow that development.
I agree. And my other question for you is, coming back full circle, so what do you think the tragedy is?
I think it is that they got Grogu again. You could argue for that, or the destruction of the Razor Crest would be, I think those are really the only two options here. But yeah, I just remember when I saw that title. I was like, oh no, it's coming. But how about you? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of feel like it. You know, it's supposed to be Grogu, but I feel like the Razor Crest is the tragedy because Grogu's recoverable. The Razor Crest at this point is not. So, but I think that it was purposely left up to interpretation, perhaps by the viewer, to decide that in and of themselves. I mean, there could be a lot up for interpretation there for sure. But there was another point that I wanted to make too about that, and I can't remember what it was. So keep talking. Maybe I'll think about it.
Well, I was just going to throw it to you for final thoughts as we start to wrap this up.
Well, I mean, like I said, from start to finish, this was absolutely amazing. I just loved it. Oh, I know what it was. Why do you think that he wanted to get Mayfield of all people? Like, why would that be his choice?
Well, we know Mayfield served with the Empire. And he was a sharpshooter, which I think implies that he maybe had more of an officer's capacity. And this goes back to that line from chapter 6 last season, where he was described as an Imperial sharpshooter. And Den went to make a comment, and Mayfield said, "I wasn't a stormtrooper, wise ass."
Yeah.
And so I think it is the one person he knows that served in the Empire that may have a way of getting to Gideon. Okay. I don't know exactly what knowledge Din Djarin. I'm expecting that something's going to be explained, or at least touched upon or hinted at, or some passing line will give us a reference to that in the next chapter. Because we've only got two left this season.
How did that happen already?
I don't know. But you know, that's the great thing about this season, is that while I loved season one of The Mandalorian, it was my top Star Wars event of the year. We just, for the first year of podcast Stardust that we just finished talking about not too long ago. But this season is consistently exciting from episode to episode. And there is really only one chapter that I don't give at least an A- this season. And that was chapter two, the second chapter of the season, chapter 10. Every chapter this season so far has had a self-contained story that contributed to the larger whole. And it's just been fantastic. The special effects have gone up a notch. The acting has been consistently great. The action has been well-paced throughout this entire thing, with a couple of minor slips, like, and my gripes about Den constantly trying to break through the force field and then putting down his jetpack, of all things. Another fantastic episode. And I would trade this season of The Mandalorian for any other season of any other show. It's been fantastic.
And I think that's a fabulous way to put it. I really do. And I agree with you. And I can't say enough about this episode, honestly. I mean, just like I said, from start to finish, it was just pure adrenaline. It really was. And I love being able to watch these shows. I set my alarm. I've set it, you know, a bazillion times for 5 a.m. before I go to school every Friday morning. And it pumps me up for my day. And I'm so excited and I'm so happy that I'm getting this Star Wars content. And, you know, I can't wait to talk to people about it. But of course, I respect the spoiler free, which I have to say, I was already seeing people posting reaction videos with the name of the episode in their picture on Twitter. Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know, okay, let people at least have at least 24 hours before you start even posting the title of the episode. I don't know. That's just my opinion. But at any rate, Fennec Shand, we've got the Seeing Stone, we've got Grogu in action, we've got, oh, the poor Razor Crest, but that was still good action. Boba Fett's back in a big way. It's bridging so many different things. And like you said, connecting some dots, which I don't think that it's fan service in that way. I think it's honestly opening up so much more to the Star Wars universe that is just so exciting. I can't say enough about it, but excellent episode.
Yeah, I agree. It was really well done for all the reasons you said. It's taking the show in new directions here that Din's going to have to rely on a whole lot of other people now because he doesn't have his own ship. He just can't make his own way. Even if he recovers a Grogu, he's now got to find a solution to protecting the kid and getting him to the next place while they evade the Empire. And even if that's achieved, he still has to figure out what he's going to do next without his own ship. So it's a definite change in the series, and it'll be a definite tone shift going forward. So well done by the entire creative team. One last thing about, I'm just going to point out, is that Ludwig Göransson's music for Boba Fett, that theme he came up with, that every time Boba would do something and then they'd kind of turn around and it's like, I love that. Yes. I cannot wait for the second half of the season 2 of The Mandalorian volume to come out on Spotify so I can listen to that again, because it was just incredible. Ludwig did an incredible job putting together some music that I really thought got to the heart of what was going on in this episode.
Well, yeah, I mean, you talk about the Chirrut Imwe vibes, and that's kind of where it almost sounds like, but yet with its own little Boba Fett flair, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, and Jedha's another place, too, we didn't even talk about as being a conduit kind of place to the Force, too, you know, where some of the ancient Jedi temples were.
Yeah. Yeah, well, at least the Guardians of the World, so.
Right, yes, yes.
But, wow, okay, we've gone way long this evening, and we've got plenty of fodder for future discussions. And with that, now I'm going to thank everyone for listening to another episode of Podcast Starters and our discussion of Chapter 14 of The Mandalorian. We are, of course, part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, Audible, or wherever it is that listens to your podcast, including the RetroZap Podcast feed. Just a few more things. If you could head over to Apple Podcasts in your spare time and leave us a 5-star rating review, we would greatly appreciate that. The reviews have slowed down as of late, and a few more would kind of help us get back into their algorithms. Also, if you got a moment, just tell your Star Wars friends about us, whether that's in person or via social media on your social media platform of choice. A personal recommendation always goes a long way and towards helping others find the show. With that being said, Jay, if you could just remind everybody where they can find us on all those social media platforms and around the internet.
Absolutely. And of course, you know, leaving us a review is the best Christmas gift or holiday gift, life day gift that you can give to us. And thanks, Dennis, for indulging me in all of my squirrel brain tonight. I really appreciate that. So if you want to contact us on social media, we are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can reach out to Dennis personally on Twitter at DJKVER2. And I am at Joyce Krebs. You can always check out our Pinterest page, and we also have a YouTube channel where you can find some unboxing videos of some really great products by yours truly. And you can also email us your thoughts at podcastartists@retrozap.com. We would love to hear your take on any and all of the things that we just talked about tonight. And again, you know, we just really kind of like parsing the weeds a little bit. There's a lot more depth that we could have gone into. So what questions do you have and what thoughts do you have? We'd love to know. And if email is just not your thing, you can always join us on Discord, where we are just one of a lot of different rooms over there on the RetroZap Discord server. And if you want to join us, just go to our community page on our show. Wait, just go to our community tab on our show page, and it'll take you right to where you need to go. And you can also support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you know, the holidays are coming up, so if you want to grab some Podcast Stardust swag for yourself or for someone else, they have coffee mugs, sweatshirts, t-shirts, stickers, masks, all kinds of different things. And we have a lot of different show logo designs over there by Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi, so you can choose one that really suits your fancy.
All right. Well, again, thanks everyone for indulging us in a longer than usual episode. But with that being said, until next time, may the Force be with you.